What's up, San Diego? John Brooks here, Congressional Candidate, District 53. It is the week of February 1st. Today, we're going to talk about what I call the exclusionary rule. Let's do this. So there have been a lot of campaign forums that have been put on by certain political groups. I think I mentioned this before. The latest was on February 3rd, because March 3rd is the election. February 3rd, a group, which I shall not name, hosted a forum along with some other. They were the main host, and then there were some other sponsors and co-sponsors. And this forum was specifically on the climate debate. So what happened was, I was at a forum put on by the Democratic Women's Club, I believe, and this one young lady came up to me afterwards and said, "Hey, I really like what you said," because I, you know, talked about climate and stuff. And she says, "I'm with and San Diego, you know, and I really appreciate what you talked about." And I said, "Oh, I've been trying to get a hold of you guys. You know, I contacted your national group, but I haven't heard anything back from them." "So yeah, we just started a local chapter." I said, "Cool." I said, "Anything I can do to help you guys, even if I don't win, let me know." I said, "Great." And then I heard someone mention that there was a climate debate coming up. And one of the candidates that was standing next to me said, "Oh, you know, I'd like to be invited to that." And then the person didn't acknowledge him. And I went, something's happening that I'm not aware of. So I went and checked. And I went on this website for another group and saw that, yes, indeed, there was a climate debate being sponsored by a progressive environmental group. And underneath the heading, it said, "These are the confirmed candidates." It was a list of the same five people that you always see. So I contacted them and I said, "Hey, look, I'm a candidate in the race for District 53. The climate crisis is my number one priority. I would like to be on stage." They wrote back and said, "This is a nonpartisan debate. We made our decision and sorry." That's basically what they said. And I'm like, okay, you're a group that claims to be inclusive and want change, and yet you're excluding people. I really don't understand this concept, how groups to the far left claim they want change, they want inclusivity, they want people to be more involved, and they want to bring the issues, which they consider to be the issues, to their followers, and yet they exclude people from speaking. How can you consciously only invite five people of a field of 15? How can you make that decision on who's viable and who's not? Because really, you can say, "Oh, well, you know, people have a right, they can go look up the candidates and research and all that." No, you know, people don't do that. They're dependent on you to guide them on who should they be looking at. So when you say only these five people are going to be on your stage speaking, you're saying that these are the only five viable candidates. Forget everyone else, even when you see their names. You go down, you scroll down, "John Brooks, who in the hell is he? All right, I want this person because I saw them talk. They don't know anything about me. They're not going to look me up, and you are not giving me a voice." That is not free speech. In a country that claims to be the greatest democracy in the world, you are shutting people out. So when you deny me a voice, you're denying democracy at work, and you're just as guilty as the people to the far right that you claim aren't allowing democracy to flourish, for lack of a better term. You know, you're no different than them when you shut people out. Who are you to make the decision on who's viable or not? And I told them, I said, "Look, it would have been better off not having the debate, because you're only letting five people speak out of 15? How's that democracy? How's that giving people a choice? There might have been one, the 10 that you excluded, that might be the best candidate this district has ever seen. So when you excluded the other 10, so you're only going to invite five people out of 15 candidates for your followers to listen to and make a decision on who they feel is the best candidate to represent them, when you've excluded 10. And one of those 10 might be the best candidate for this district, or it could have been someone else. But the point is, you're not allowing people to speak. That is not right. That's not democracy. And you really disappointed me and the people of this country, because you're no different than the system that you're trying to change. You're playing into the same paradigm as the way the system is set up. You claim you want money out of politics, Citizens United overturned, fair and equitable society, an environment that's safe and clean for our children, and reverse the effects of the climate catastrophe. And yet here you are excluding people, making choices for people based on what you feel is best. That's all the other people are doing, what they feel is best. And you won't even talk to them. Not you personally, but people to the far right never talk to the people to the far left, because they think they're all crazy. And the fact is, you're both crazy. See, the thing is, I'm not a Republican, right? But I have a lot of Republican friends, and we get along just fine on a lot of different issues. yeah, there's some things that I don't agree with them, and vice versa. The same thing I do with some progressive Democrats, i.e. the people who excluded me. But to say that they're all crazy and you're not going to listen to them, that's the crazy part. Because you can say, oh, we're going to fight for this, and we're going to win, and we're going to take back the House and the Senate and the presidency, and it's going to be all Democrat. Yeah. That worked out real well for us in the past too, right? The thing is, and I've said this before, when two people fight, or two people, when you fight for something, not two people in general, someone loses. And in general, humans don't like losing. So that person is going to try to come back with a vengeance. Why not try to build a consensus and build partnership, as opposed to trying to fight and beat somebody up and beat them down? Because that's not that's not making them change their opinion. You just beat them into submission temporarily. So I'm not about fighting unless your life is at stake. Yeah, so it's crazy. I'm really disappointed in this system, and it's clearer to me every day how skewed this system is. Even the political parties, you know, the Democratic Party, they held the nomination, the period to nominate or to recommend for who they're gonna nominate in certain districts. I wasn't told about that. It wasn't even considered. They just nominated somebody before the nomination period on who can submit their applications to the San Diego Register of Voters was closed. So, and even some of the groups, they make their endorsements before they knew who all the candidates were. So how fair is that? It's clear to me that most of these groups have personal agendas just as much as they claim the lobbyists who are putting all the money into the political system have. You're doing the same thing, you just don't have as much money. Now here I'm running a no money campaign and you're excluding me because I don't have any money at all. When you say it, this is the excuses people gave me. Oh, well, we checked the figures and we went on who raised the most money and who's the most popular and blah, blah, blah. There's no polls taken. Well, who's the most popular? When did this become a popularity contest? Who's the best candidate? If someone's running, if someone spends their money, right, to be on this ballot, which could be anywhere from $1,700, give or take, up to $5,000, to get on that ballot, have your name printed, et cetera, et cetera, and you're going to say, you just wasted your money. We're not even considering you. You're not viable because you're not raising thousands of dollars and you don't have corporate support and union support and all this kind of stuff. So I blame those groups. I blame the lobbyists who have money and the lobbyists who don't have money. The ones who are on grassroots support, because they're just as guilty if you're excluding people. But I'm also going to blame you guys if you're not voting. So if you just sit back and say, yeah, that's the way the system is, it's all corrupt and nothing's going to change, so I'm just going to abstain. There are more people who don't vote than vote. So in the act of not voting, you're actually voting. I'm not saying you're like Al Gore didn't win because people didn't vote, or Trump won because enough people didn't vote to give Hillary Clinton the electoral votes necessary. No, the system is, part of this problem also is there's only two choices, Democrat and Republican. This is wrong. We need to have more than two parties in the system because they're two parties of the same coin. They're in it for themselves, not for you. And you have the power, I say this on my speeches, don't give your power away. You have the power to make change, but you have to stay in the game. If you just vote one time and say, oh, Obama is going to be great, blah, 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 and just sit back and don't do nothing, let Obama take care of it, yeah, you're going to have some issues. You need to stay engaged in the process. We all do. It's work. It's not easy. But nothing that is good is easy. So you have a choice. The mail-in ballots are going out this week, the week of February 1st. So you can actually vote now. You can take your ballot, run up to the registrar of voters and cast it or put it in the mail, because actually it's postage free this year. Plus you get your little sticker in there that says I voted, so you can do that. Or you can wait till March 3rd until you hear more about what the candidates are about and the issues and stuff like that. But the choice is yours. And win or lose, but I still plan on winning, I'm not done with the climate debate. This is the most important issue facing humanity today. It needs to be addressed. And if I can't address it on the political level, I will address it as a citizen. Because, you know, nothing else matters, really. I'll sell my house. I'll spend every dime I have, because really it's pointless having this stuff when we're not going to have a planet to live on. So, having said all that, have a wonderful day on that happy note. I'm just joking. No, I'm not joking. I'm joking about on a happy note. It is grim. And we really need to believe that in order to make things happen. You know, it's funny. If there's a war imminent danger, we just jump into action right away. Don't worry about the money. We just get into it. Well, we're in a war right now with the climate. Even though it's slow and you don't see the effects right now, it's killing you slowly. And unless you engage, we will all lose. On that happy note, have a wonderful day. Peace out.